Welcome back. Ferguson, Missouri, of course, not the only flashpoint in the nation when it comes to racial tension and the actions of police. Our region's been focused on the police-related death of Eric Garner, who was killed by a chokehold from a police officer in Staten Island on July 17th. There have been protests and demands for a change in police tactics and actions since, and a major rally is planned for this Saturday in Staten Island. Garner's death came as broken windows comes into greater focus, the focus on smaller crimes that police say then deter people from committing more serious crimes. But the results have shown a racial imbalance, more stops and arrests of people of color at a rate that's out of whack with population numbers, like we saw with Stop and Frisk before it and a host of other police approaches. But supporters of those policies say without them, regardless of who's being arrested, you would see an uptick in crime, shootings, and murders. And this weekend, in a post-Stop and Frisk environment, we did see gunfire and violence ringing out across the Big Apple. More now from Fox 1's Samantha Liebman.
A violent weekend in New York City. Between midnight Friday and midnight Sunday, there were 13 separate incidents, injuring 21 people, killing two. The suspect in the double homicide caught on surveillance, brazenly shooting on a Hamilton Heights street corner. Distraught friends and family of 21-year-old Kenny Jimenez and 26-year-old Francisco Mercedes continue to surround a growing makeshift memorial where they were gunned down. Meanwhile, Mayor Bill de Blasio says despite the uptick, overall crime in the city is down.
We're doing that consistently by applying officers into the areas of greatest need, into the precincts with the greatest challenges, into some of the NYCHA developments with greatest challenges. And by and large, that effort has been bearing fruit. But whenever we see any uptick in shooting, we apply additional resources quickly.
And crime is down despite a decrease in the use of stop and frisk. According to the NYPD, there were 130,000 less stops through June of this year compared with the same time last year. But Councilmember Jermani Williams, who sponsored legislation passed last year to make police more accountable for racial profiling, says there is no scientific correlation between fewer stops and more shootings.
But everybody wants to rush to violate the Constitution and over-police communities where it hasn't really done the job that we wanted to do.
And while shootings are up just over 10% from the same time last year, murders are down 12%, on path for a record low. But Williams thinks police aren't the only solution. He's hopeful that the expansion of a program from 5 to 14 precincts, a gun violence crisis management system announced by the mayor and council speaker last week, will help.
For the people in the street to work on the people who are most likely to do these shootings and the biggest hot spots in the area, but we put wraparound services on it.
Those wraparound services include legal, mental health, as well as job training and placement. Williams believes the effects will be felt by next summer. Unfortunately, too late for the two men gunned down here in Hamilton Heights. I'm Samantha Liebman reporting for RFL.
Gentlemen, I think we all know that despite what the numbers say, and the numbers indicate that the number of murders are down and crime is down in New York City, that incidents like the number of shootings we saw this weekend are going to lead critics of the mayor of New York, critics of the of just critics in general, to say that, well, we're descending into a chaotic situation because we've eased back on policing. I'm curious your reaction.
Well, the police played lots of games, okay? One of the games is that if you can determine if crime is up or down based on whether you decide to make an arrest. So if you want to arrest every person that has an open container or has a marijuana cigarette, you can do that and say, well, crime is up. Or you can ignore fights when people go in and with a black eye and say, I've been assaulted, and you say, no, you haven't been. So you have a lot of discretion there. And you see it right now in Ferguson, where after the police were criticized, they decided to stop intervening when people were looting. Well, there's no reason for you to stop intervening when people are looting. Nobody would ask that for that to happen. And the police, they had tanks, right? They were in their full military garb. Why couldn't they stop somebody from going in and stealing the TV? So what they're basically doing is saying, well, unless you do what we want you to do, we're not going to police at all. And that's not what you need. You need people who are professional, people whose skin is not so thin that they take personal offense. The police are supposed to be the ones with the thick skin. And the brass, the leadership in particular, swears an oath to defend and to protect the people in the community, and when necessary, to arrest them and to use no more force than necessary. That's what they're supposed to do. What happens is that when the union is not getting its contract, you don't see any arrests. You see it in every city. You can go to Westchester County right now, go to White Plains, very few arrests. And when times are good and overtime is being paid, then you see tons of arrests.